blessed city with lots of good churches, but I believe that God sets us. How many know Israel was one nation, but it had 12 tribes? And you got to find your tribe, amen? And well, we love you guys. Thank you for being here. And this is our year to build. How many are ready to keep pushing forward into 2017? Amen. We talked on New Year's that number 17 in the Bible is the number that represents complete victory over your enemies. I believe you're going to have complete victory over your enemies this year. And we're going to talk about building. We're talking about building strategies, and we are unpacking the book of Nehemiah over the next few weeks. If you missed last Sunday, you can get online, jubileeintl.org, and you can click on our media, and you can watch the messages there online to catch up if you missed last week, because we're going to build one on another, and we're going to see God put inside of you some strategies that are going to help you see something in your life that you've never seen before. And I believe we're going to see something happen in this church in the nature of building that we've never seen before as a church. Amen? How many believe God is the God of the impossible? How many believe we could be doing some expansion as early as this year? Amen. God needs to open the door. God has spoken a lot of things to me. I'm going to be sharing them with you over the next few weeks. And so especially if this is your home church, you want to pay close attention and you want to get on board with what we're talking about. Well, we're talking about these building strategies from Nehemiah. Today, I want to specifically talk about the strategy of capturing divine opportunity, recognizing and capturing divine opportunity. Some people get so busy seeing the chaos around them that they can't see the opportunity that God has for them. And many times it's in the chaos that your biggest opportunity comes. Many times it's in your challenge that your biggest opportunity will follow. Many miracles, many deliverances are born out of bad times, not just good times. And you have to always be watching for what God wants to bring to you. So Nehemiah was one of the great leaders of all time. He was a faithful servant that God gave an opportunity to, and he was willing to restructure his life, rearrange his life to step into the purposes of God, and was used by God to perform one of the greatest miracles in Scripture, the rebuilding of the walls of Jerusalem in his day. And we're going to talk about why that was such a dramatic miracle in another message ahead. But Nehemiah faced this daunting challenge, this impossible situation, but he did something miraculous because he was willing to act. How many know when you see an opportunity, you have to seize the opportunity? Nudge somebody next to you, say, seize the opportunity. Come on, you got to work with me today. I need some help. Amen? It's the chaos of the time that creates the conqueror in the man. And you have to understand that what you walk through will make you or break you. Let it make you. March 13th, 1964, a long time ago. Well, a long time for some, depending on what. Some of you are like, that wasn't that long ago. Listen. In 1964, there was actually a tragic event that happened late one April in New York City. A young lady whose name was Catherine Kitty Genovese was headed home after her night shift to her Queensboro apartment. She was about 2:30 in the morning. She parked her car in the parking lot, and as she was walking from the parking lot to her apartment building, she was attacked, she was raped, she was robbed, and she was stabbed multiple times, which eventuated in her death. The episode had lasted over a half an hour. And even though you can say, well, that happens so often in our culture, and it's a tragedy, but here's the thing. She called out for help and screamed during that 30 minutes while 38 people watched and did nothing. Not one of them called the police until the very end. A lady came down and held her while the police came. Not one of them stepped in to rescue her. They listened and they watched. It was plastered all over the New York Times. It was such a shock to our nation that nobody would get involved in something so tragic. Even a senator who heard about it read the report in shock before the U.S. Congress. It's a syndrome called personal non-involvement. The watchword of many people. I'm too busy. I don't have time. I have my own stuff to deal with. I'm not going to put myself out there like that. I have my own life to focus on. And we increasingly become more isolated and more cocooned in our own trajectory as life goes on. But all around us, there are things that are happening. All around us, there are things that are under attack that we cannot ignore. And as the Church of Jesus Christ, much of the church in our generation has been like those 38 people in April of 1964. We stand by and we watch, we gasp, we talk after church about how terrible it is. But we have to be willing to seize the opportunity that God has given us to do what he's called us to do, to be involved. To be involved personally, to be involved in the vision. And today, wherever you're here, wherever you came from today and entered in this service, I believe this is a word directly for you, because let me tell you, if you're alive and breathing, there is an opportunity ahead for you that you haven't seen yet, and God is going to show it to you. So we come back to this story in Nehemiah. Nehemiah had just heard a difficult report about his homeland of Jerusalem. Although because of captivity of his people, he was actually born in captivity. He's never been to his homeland. But he hears the report, and the report he hears is tragic. It affects him profoundly. He weeps and he prays to the God of heaven. But what he does next is most important. He sets himself before the Lord and he arranges his life to become involved in the situation for his people. God is calling us to become involved in something. Have you ever hoped for good news, but bad news came instead? Have you ever expected bad news, but when you heard it, it was even worse than you expected? That's what happened with Nehemiah. That's exactly what happened. He knew the city had been destroyed. It had been destroyed 100 years ago by the Babylonians. They had come and they had sacked the city. They had taken all of it. They had pillaged it. They had taken all of its treasures, and they carried off all of the people and made them slaves of Babylon. For 70 years, they remained slaved until another empire called Persia came and it destroyed Babylon. Now, under the Persian Empire, some of the Jewish people were allowed to return back to their homeland. Their homeland had not only been destroyed, but other people and tribes in the area had moved in and taken over the land. So when they went back to try to start rebuilding and try to start resetting their lives, they got a lot of resistance. Persia had sent different leaders to try to help the situation, to try to help the conflict. Zerubbabel was one of the governors in that area. He'd become a courageous leader. Ezra, after which one of the books in the Bible is named Ezra, was a priest who went and he motivated the rebuilding of the temple. And that's what they put God's house first. We talked about that last week. And then there was Nehemiah. Nehemiah was a servant directly to the king of Persia himself, King Artaxerxes. He was the cupbearer of the king. We talked about what that meant last week. He was in charge of protecting the king. He guarded his sleeping quarters at night. He would taste his food and his drink to make sure if there was any poison, Nehemiah would die first. How many want that job? Well, that job was a very trusted job with the king. It was one of the closest relationships that a king had. So Nehemiah had it good. How easy would it be for Nehemiah? Great position, right? Great life. Heard stories from his father, but he's living in the palace. How easy would it be for him to ignore the problem? Well, that's such a sad, I wish it wasn't that way, but it's so far away. And I'm really not in a position to do anything. I mean, it wasn't like a job that he could quit. This was an assignment that he had. He was a servant of the king. Well, that's the attitude of a lot of people when they look into a generation that has come under attack. We look and we're like, that's so sad. I wish there was something I could do about it. And we get comfortable. And when we get comfortable, our comfort can cause us to miss opportunities that God has for us, to miss open doors to be used by God, to miss resources. If you want to get from the place where you are to a place you've never been before, you can't get too comfortable. I've never seen somebody that was incredibly gifted or creative or strong in leadership that was also comfortable. They typically are people that push and work hard and look for opportunities. Those who insist on their comfort can miss their growth pattern. Those who insist on their comfort can miss their divine opportunity, but that's not what happened with Nehemiah. When he received the report of the things that were happening in Jerusalem about the resistance on his people, it shook him to his core. But it also moved him that he was going to be a part of a vision to do something about it. Let me say this. When God gets ready to reveal to you what you have in you, he will often put you in a challenge. When God wants to reveal what's in you, he'll put you under some pressure, because what's inside of something will come out when it's squeezed. Amen? Amen. Just squeeze the person next to you a little bit. Just squeeze them a little bit. Come on, what's in you is going to come out of you when you're squeezed. Turning your Bibles to Ezra chapter 4. The reason I want you to look at Ezra while we're talking about Nehemiah is because Ezra gives us a picture of what was happening in Jerusalem while Nehemiah was serving the king hundreds and hundreds of miles away in Persia. There was a damaging letter that had been sent to Artaxerxes the king by a man by the name of Rehum. Rehum was a Persian official that was living in the region of Samaria. He wrote to Artaxerxes to inform him that the Jews he had allowed to return were rebuilding the city. In verse 12, it says they were finishing the walls and repairing the foundations. In Ezra chapter 4 and verse 13, he said, "Let it be known to the king that if the city is rebuilt and the walls are finished, these people are not going to pay tribute, custom, or toll, and it will damage the revenue of the kings." This letter came to Artaxerxes' attention. After researching the history of Jerusalem, he quickly recognized what might happen if the Jews succeeded in their efforts. He responds with a command that the work must be stopped. So the king of Persia gets this letter from Rehum and he says, "Listen, don't let them continue if they're going to try to revolt against me." And the Bible says in Ezra 4 and verse 23, he went in haste to Jerusalem to the Jews and stopped them by force of arms. He took up arms against them. Rehum and his men literally attacked the walls of Jerusalem and broke them down and set gates on fire. The Jews were absolutely demoralized. Years of hard work and many lives went up in smoke. During the Second World War, the German forces made a strategy to attack the beautiful city of Warsaw in Poland. Not only did the Nazis bomb the city from the air, their ground attack was even more devastating. They went from building to building throughout the whole city, destroying each structure with dynamite. The whole city was demolished. Hitler's strategy was to break the morale of the Polish people, and he calculated he could accomplish that by destroying Warsaw. It was the seat of Polish pride and their sense of accomplishment. Well, Rehum had the exact same strategy in Jerusalem. He wrote these words to King Artaxerxes. King Artaxerxes sent the rule back to him, and he took it to the extreme. And he said, "I'm going to smash the morale of the Jewish people. I'm going to destroy their walls, and I'm going to burn their gates with fire. I'm going to completely annihilate everything that they love and hold dear." And this is what the Jewish people were under. The despair was enormous. They were at an all-time low. And now he faced what he thought would be an impossible task. The king, Artaxerxes, was the only person who could humanly solve this problem. But he was the one that gave the order. Only the king could reverse that order. And that's why Nehemiah was so discouraged in his heart. And that's why he began to pray to God to grant him compassion before this man that he served. Let me tell you something today. The enemy's goal in your life is to demoralize you. He wants to use your mistakes. He wants to use your failures. He wants to use the thoughts of other people. He wants to use words spoken over you. He wants to use whatever he can to distract you and to destroy the purposes of God in your life. He wants to hide God's opportunities from you, but I'm going to preach a message to you today that I believe is going to open your eyes to the opportunities of God for your life. Do you believe that? I believe it's going to open the doors for this church as well. Amen. But sometimes you have to have a little pressure, like toothpaste in a tube. It won't come out without some pressure. Come on, you don't hear what I'm preaching about yet, but you're going to get it. So we read the 11 verses of the first chapter last week. That was the setup. Nehemiah chapter 1, he knows he's going to have to face the king of Persia. He gets this report of what's happened back in Jerusalem. But he's the king's cupbearer. He's responsible for the king. He's not one that's really allowed to interfere too much in the king's business. What is he going to do? God was setting up a divine opportunity, and Nehemiah held the key to unlock the door to that opportunity. I see keys in some of your hands today to opportunities that God is preparing for you. If you have your Bibles, look at Nehemiah chapter 2. And we're going to begin right at the first verse. And it came to pass in the month of Nisan. Not talking about the vehicle. It was the time of year. In the 20th year of King Artaxerxes, when the wine was before him, that I took the wine and gave it to the king. Now I had never been sad in his presence before. I want you to pay attention to that line. I had never been sad in his presence before. That's a significant statement. Therefore, the king said to me, why is your face sad since you are not sick? This is nothing but sorrow of heart. So I became dreadfully afraid and said to the king, may the king live forever. Why should my face not be sad when the city, the place of my father's tombs, lies in waste and its gates are burned with fire? Now I want to go back to verse 1. It had been 4 months between chapter 1 and chapter 2. Chapter 1 tells us it opened up in the month of Kislev. That would have been November, December. Now we're in the month of Nisan, which would have been about mid-April. It's been 4 months since representatives came from Jerusalem and gave the news to Nehemiah in Persia about what was happening in Jerusalem. 4 months Nehemiah prayed. 4 months Nehemiah waited. 4 months Nehemiah pressed into the face of God. He knew the need. It was an urgent matter. But for 4 months, he could do nothing but seek God. How many know when God gives you a word to do something, it doesn't always happen immediately when he gives you the word? Sometimes you have to press into God. Sometimes you have to believe God. Sometimes you have to know that what God has told you, it may not have happened yet, but it's going to happen. Why? Because God wants to do a work in you first, so that you can be prepared when God puts in your hand what he wants you to do. He works in you before he works outside of you. So he waits, and although Nehemiah performed his usual duties, there was something uniquely different about his countenance. He looked sad. He looked depressed, even sickly. And he said, I had never been sad in his presence before. Now, I want you to understand why this is important. Because servants, if you study Persian history, the history of this time period, servants in the king's court in Persia, by law, were required to be happy. Can you imagine that was part of your job description? You had to be happy. Even if you didn't feel happy, you had to act happy, right? It happens today in restaurants and service industry. You go to CC's, welcome to CC's, right? Their life might be falling apart, but they still have to smile and welcome you, right? Well, this is exactly what happened in the king's court, right? It was against Persian law for these servants, particularly the cupbearer, to show sorrow in the king's presence. They could be banished or they could be killed. In fact, Nehemiah not only had to show honor, he could send a wrong message, because if you were the cupbearer, you tasted the king's food and drink before he did, and if it was poisoned, guess who would get sick first? The cupbearer. Well, what happened if it wasn't the food and drink, but you were just having an emotional moment at home, and you came and you were eating and drinking, and the king, you look sad and sick, and he's like, uh-oh, you're going to die. Now the king's not going to eat his food and drink, but then he realizes it was just a personal problem. You just messed up the king's meal, and that's not good for you, right? You could send the wrong message. And so when he told this to Nehemiah, Nehemiah was afraid. He was afraid. He didn't know what the king was going to do or how he was going to respond. The king says, why is your face sad since you're not sick? Then the king concluded, this is just sorrow of your heart. And the Bible says Nehemiah became dreadfully afraid. And he answers the king. And he says, let the king live forever. Amen. That's a good statement. No, be alive. Yay, king. Amen. You want to make sure. He's like, listen, I'm on your side. But let me tell you something about Nehemiah. For 4 months, he had been looking for the opportunity. And when the opportunity comes, you better be ready for it or you might miss it. He was looking for the open door. And when the king posed the question, Nehemiah knew this was the time, and he was ready with the answer. With great wisdom, he speaks in verse 3. Why should my face not be sad when the city, the place of my father's tombs, lies waste and its gates are burned with fire? Nehemiah demonstrates great wisdom in that moment by what he said. Because Artaxerxes, if you read a couple of verses later, was sitting there next to his queen, and Nehemiah was serving them, meaning there was probably a party going on. So this was probably in front of other people that the king questions Nehemiah. Nehemiah had to be very careful with his choice of words. He knew this was not the time to embarrass Artaxerxes or threaten Artaxerxes. And so he was a man of faith, but he did not walk in presumption. How many know you can have great faith, but you also need great wisdom? He appealed to the king's values. Artaxerxes had a great reverence for relatives and friends, especially those who had passed away or those who had been treated wrongly. So when Nehemiah did not refer to Jerusalem specifically, but he said, the place where my father's tombs are lies in ruin. This was wise words because it spoke into the heart of the king. God will reveal divine wisdom to you. God will give you divine strategy for the success of what he's calling you to do. God gives divine wisdom and strategy for us as a church in how we reach, how we build, what we do. And what I like about this is that the king is not overly upset when he responds. Obviously, the king and Nehemiah have a fairly close relationship to begin with. But I like what Proverbs 21 says. You don't have to turn there, but it says the king's heart is in the hand of the Lord. Like rivers of water, he turns it wherever he wishes. How many know concerning kings and leaders of nations, we're in a political change in our nation right now? Let me tell you something real clear. When it comes to kings and leaders in the world, God's hand is sovereign, and he can move kings' hearts where he wants to. It doesn't matter who the person is. Our trust is not in man. Our trust is in the Lord. Come on, that should make some of you happy right now. Hallelujah. Here's what I want you to see. In Nehemiah 1, he hears the news, he prays, and he weeps. In chapter 2, he remembers the news, and he prays, but he takes action. Now, God has his own action timetable for you. And the thing is, God's time and your time might not be the same time. Always go with God's time. He can see what you can't see. But there is divine opportunity that will emerge for you if you will look for it. If you will keep your eyes open and your heart set, God is going to show you divine opportunity. Waiting on the Lord is never a waste of time. It's always an investment of time. Because while you're waiting on the Lord, the Bible says God is renewing your strength. While you are waiting on the Lord, God is preparing you on the inside. While you are waiting on the Lord, God is stretching your faith. Waiting on the Lord is never a waste. It's always an investment. That's a side note. That's free. Verse 4. Then the king said to me, "What do you request?" And I love what Nehemiah did immediately. I prayed to the God of heaven. Now, he's standing in this room full of people. But how many know when your heart is set, you've been seeking God for 4 months, it doesn't take very long to pray. What it really meant was he connected his heart to the Lord. He focused on God first, and then he responded. How many know a lot of times we speak first and pray later when everything falls apart? But God wants us to reverse the order. He wants us to connect to him first. If you will learn immediately when you're faced with a problem, if you will train yourself to connect with God first before you act or react, it'll change everything. And you'll be able to step into things that otherwise would not be given to you. That's a powerful thing. So he stands and he connects to God, not lengthy or loud. Sometimes you can make a very targeted prayer in about 3 words. Help me now. Amen. How many know that works sometimes? It said he prayed to the God of heaven. He said the same thing in chapter 1 when he got the news. He prayed to the God of heaven. Listen, when we pray, let me say this. Sometimes it's easy to forget who we're praying to. We see God as some kind of a superhuman that does us right sometimes and does us wrong sometimes. And our prayer, "God, please do me right." And then when it doesn't go our way, we get mad at God. As if God can make a mistake. Right? God is not the big guy upstairs. He's God. He's enthroned. He rules the universe. He sees the end from the beginning. He already has the script of your life written out. He already knows what is ahead for you. When you pray to God and when you are a child of God, you have to know who you are. And Nehemiah knew who he was. And when he connected to the God of the universe, he knew that that power was higher than the earthly power he was speaking to. Amen. The greatest of our lives on earth are still tiny. They're still small. We see from such a limited perspective. But when you stand before the King of heaven, it's never a problem to stand before a king of this world. Amen. When you fear the King of heaven, you don't ever have to be afraid of a king on the earth. Hallelujah. The king's reply must have shocked Nehemiah when he said that, because rather than responding with anger and charging his guards to get Nehemiah out of there, he responds positively. Why? Because God holds the hearts of kings. God, guys, and he says, "What do you request?" At that moment, in that very word, in that verse, a door of opportunity opens in front of Nehemiah. And he had to know what he wanted and what he needed in that moment. Instantly, God gave Nehemiah the ability to use what he had gleaned from his faithful time with the Lord. And Nehemiah carefully and wisely chose his words so that he could connect God's divine plan with human resources to achieve what God had called him to do. God wants to connect you with his plan in human resources to accomplish what he's calling you to do. God is connecting this house, this church, with God's plan in human resources so that we can get to the place where God is calling us to be. I believe that. Amen. Do you believe it? Come on. We have to be prepared for the opportunities that God brings to us. You know why we begin our services with this lengthy time of music and worship? Why do we give glory and praise to God as the first and maybe one of the biggest pieces of our time together? It's not just because we need a time filler before the message. It's we do it because it's how we prepare. It's how we adjust our perspective. Because when you worship, it causes you to fix your focus on God. And it takes a while. Sometimes you come in here, all kinds of things have happened on the way to church. All kinds of things have happened last week. And God has to fix your focus. Hit somebody next to you, say, fix your focus. There, a couple of you just woke up then. All right. Fix your focus. Faith is activated in worship. Hearts are prepared in worship. Focus is clarified in worship. This is one of the most powerful building strategies we do as a church, coming together in worship. If you will set your focus every day, if you will start your day with worship, it will set your focus and it'll change the course of your entire day. How many know if you're not focused, if your eyes are blurry, you're gonna not see the opportunity when it comes your way? Look at how bold Nehemiah got when he fixed his focus on the God of heaven. Verse 5, and I said to the king, if it pleases the king, and if your servant has found favor in your sight, I ask that you send me to Judah, to the city of my father's tombs. He says it again. That I may rebuild it. Then the king said to me, the queen also sitting beside him, how long will your journey be? How many know when the king answers you with a question, you know you're in the door? You've stepped across the threshold of opportunity. When will you return? So it pleased the king to send me, and I set him a time. Furthermore, I said to the king, if it pleases the king, let letters be given to me. He was already prepared with the strategy. He already knew what was coming next. Okay, you're going to let me go. Here's what I need. I need letters that permit me to pass through till I come to Judah, and give me another letter for Asaph, the keeper of the king's forest, that he must give me timber to make beams for the gates of the citadel, which pertains to the temple, for the city wall, and for the house that I will occupy. He said, I need some resources, king, because we have some things to rebuild. We need some structural change done in the temple. We have to rebuild the gates of the city. And by the way, I need a place to live as well. Would you give me a letter? I need your resources. And the king did what he asked. Woo! It says, the king granted them to me according to the good hand of my God upon me. When you know that the hand of God is on your life, you can step forward. You don't have to over-spiritualize something. You don't have to use fancy words. You can simply ask. And the hand of the Lord will bring the provision that you need to fulfill the call that he's called you to do. But if you don't see the opportunity and you don't know where you're going and you don't know what you're doing, you don't know what resources you need, things don't work out. But when you fix your focus, prepare your heart. I'm telling you, God's going to open some doors for you, not just this year, but before the end of this month for some of you. Even in this morning service, between this morning service and the second service, I already got feedback of a door that was open for somebody in the first service. I'm telling you, God is going to open divine opportunities for you. So Nehemiah prepared the answer for the king. He answers his divine opportunity. He brings his request. I want you to notice a couple of things. First of all, Nehemiah has maintained a good reputation. There is no substitute for a good reputation when it comes to opportunities. You can be bypassed, you can be demoted if you don't have the right reputation. If you haven't kept yourself acting right, responding right, I know it's easy to let your emotions get out of control. It happens to me too. I know it's easy to react and respond in ways you shouldn't, but if you will guard your heart and if you will set yourself, your response will open the doors of heaven for you, just like they did for Nehemiah. Another key factor, notice that the queen was sitting next to King Artaxerxes. It was a moment for the king to make a statement in front of his queen, and guess who recognized that? Nehemiah. He must have known something about the king because he knew if he asked him something in front of his wife, just like any man with a wife knows, we're going to answer in relation to how our wife might think about it as well. So the king could have responded with power or permission, and he responded with permission. Nehemiah was a smart guy. He was wise in the Lord, and the hand of God was on him. And he knew that even one misspoken word could destroy the whole thing. Look at Nehemiah's approach. He speaks humbly before the king Artaxerxes of Persia. He said, if it pleases the king, and if I have found favor, I love this because I love what Nehemiah doesn't do here. He doesn't go in announcing, King, I have a word from God, and God is sending me back to my homeland, and you have to let me go. And I'm submitted to him, and whether you like it or not, I'm going back to Jerusalem because God said. He didn't do that. I love that he didn't do that. It's so easy for us when we're putting demands on, we got something in our heart, we want to see it happen right now. We throw it, well, God said to do this, and I don't have to worry about this, and God told me to, I'm just going to do it. I don't care what you think about it, but listen, you'll never accomplish the will of God by being pushy and using God's name to validate your agenda. But Nehemiah goes in humbly, trusting, listen to this, trusting that God is able to work through human authority. God is able to work through human authority. If you know God's hand is on something, you don't have to go in pushing and drop and name dropping and making everything happen. If God's hand is on something, God has the power. You have to know who God is in your life. Do you hear what I'm saying to you? A key in strategic building in God's kingdom, whether you are a leader of leaders, wherever you are in your life, is the principle of submission. If it pleases the king, Nehemiah said. Some people say, well, Pastor Lynn, I don't need to submit to any man. I just submit to God. But submitting to God means submitting to both spiritual and secular leadership. Because God commands us to do it, because God is a God of order, he's a God of government. And I'm telling you, even if you don't think you're getting the response you want, if you will speak honorably to those that are in authority, it will bring favor upon you, and God can move the hearts of men. Trust me on that. Trust me on that. It's the simple principle, if it pleases the king. God can even move the hearts of wicked kings for his glory. Now Nehemiah stands before a wide open door of opportunity. The king answers with an affirming question, how long will your journey be? And when will you return? So it pleased the king to send me. Nehemiah requests these two things. Number one, credibility. Say credibility. He asked for letters of permission from the king himself. So when he reaches Jerusalem, he has the authority of the king behind him. He knew the only way he would be permitted to lead what he needed to lead was to have the king's signature. He asked for credibility. God will be your credibility. The second thing he asked for was provision. Say provision. Nehemiah asked for access to the king's forest. He requested a letter to Asaph, the man in charge of the king's timber. Nehemiah already knew the location. He already knew the person in charge. He already knew how much he needed. And he asked the king for permission. He already had a plan. How many know God will bless your plan? Right? You're praying for God's blessing. God's going to bless you with a plan. You take the plan and watch what God does with it. He knew he would need access to the materials to rebuild the walls in the parts of the city. He knew he would need a place to live himself. Verse 9. Then I went to the governors in the region beyond the river and gave them the king's letters. Now when the king had sent captains of the army and horsemen with me, when Sanballat the Horonite and Tobiah the Ammonite, remember those names, Sanballat and Tobiah, because you'll hear those again in another message. They were deeply disturbed that a man had come to seek the well-being of the children of Israel. Just plant this little marker in your mind that anti-Semitism has ancient roots. It's nothing new. It has been throughout history because Satan inspires it. Satan hates God's covenants. And Satan is angry that the Jews and Israel should be blessed. And he's angry that they should be given a homeland to live in that was theirs anyway. This is important to understand because God keeps his covenants. And in the same way, God will honor his people Israel. If you are born again and in the family of God, God will honor his covenant with you through Jesus. He will honor his covenant. He is a man of his word. He is not a man that he should lie. It may not be on your timetable. You might not know when it's all coming to pass, but God will finish what he started in you. He'll finish his word. Amen. So let's look at these men. These men are representative. Sanballat, the governor of Samaria, he's worried because a new kid on the block means less territory for him to control. It also means less taxation revenue for him, and that's going to shrink his pocketbook. Then you have Tobiah the Ammonite. The Ammonites have been enemies of Israel for a long time. In Deuteronomy, God says the Ammonites are your enemy. In fact, do you remember Balaam, the false prophet in the Bible, whose donkey spoke to him? Do you remember that story? If you haven't, it's a really interesting story. You should read it. Well, Balaam was inspired by the Ammonites to curse the nation of Israel. So the Ammonites were definitely not friends with Israel. These two men were enemies of Nehemiah, and they were enemies of Israel. So look at what Nehemiah does. He comes to Jerusalem. He was there 3 days, verse 11 says. And then it says, I arose in the night, I and a few men with me. I told no one what my God had put in my heart to do at Jerusalem, nor was there any animal with me except the one on which I rode. So understand, he had come to Jerusalem, the Bible says, with a whole entourage that the king sent with him. He had materials, he had people, he had power, he had letters. He was coming with all of the ornate accessories of Persia with him, coming into this kingdom. But he waited till night, and he went, and he begins to survey the city. And he doesn't tell anybody what he's doing. How many know sometimes we talk too much too quickly, and it messes things up? But he needed to assess what needed to be done. Verse 13, I went out by night through the valley gate to the serpent well and the refuse gate, and I viewed the walls of Jerusalem, which were broken down, and its gates that had been burned with fire. I went on to the fountain gate on the other side of the city, the king's pool, but there was no room for the animal under me to pass through the street. That's how littered the roads were with the rubble from the walls. The animal could not even walk down the road. So I went up in the night by the valley and viewed the wall, and then I turned back and entered by the valley gate and returned. And the officials did not know where I had gone or what I had done. I had not yet told the Jews, the priests, the nobles, the officials, or the others who did the work. Now, I'm sure Nehemiah encountered several key leaders. I'm sure he spoke to Ezra, who had been there. He spent some time in the temple. He spent 3 days there recovering from his journey. But before he did anything, he walked around the city and began to hear what God was saying to him. By the way, there's evidence today that you can go see in Israel that Nehemiah was there in Jerusalem. There are several walls that you can trace back to the rebuilding of the walls of Nehemiah that are still there today, including the broad wall that is so wide you can walk on it today. Nehemiah's work there was powerful, and it lasted a long time. The end of last year, on several weeks, and even once in the beginning of this year, I've driven to some strategic places in this city, and I've prayed, I've been seeking the Lord about what God wants to do about the state of the city. and about the place that he's called us as a church to be a part of and what he's called us to do. And the Lord has been speaking to me, and I'm going to share some of those things over the next 2 or 3 weeks because it has everything to do with you. And let me tell you something from the Spirit of the Lord. God is getting ready to do something profound in this region. I was looking back. I was talking to Joe before the service, before the second service today. Joe, a few years back, he and his wife Karina set up a prayer specifically for the city of Pensacola. And that, how many years ago did you start that, Joe? Did you do that the first time? About 10 years ago. Have you noticed some changes in Pensacola in the last 10 years? Some development, some changes, some restructuring? How many know God responds to his people? It's not about who the mayor is. It's not about who the chief of police is. It's about who the church is. Because God moves through his people. And God has been saying to me things about that he's doing here and from here in our nation. And he's also been speaking to me about the nations. We're going to hear some of that next week. That's why we got all the flags up, because we're talking about the nations now, pushing 80 nations. Dave Wagner, he was up praying. He just flew in late last night from Cambodia, another nation that's never been touched. This is another 61st nation for you to minister in, which makes probably close to 80 nations we've ministered in as a church in the last 30 years. How many know God wants to do something supernatural and there are new opportunities ahead? And I read the lengthy text that you sent me, Dave, about all of the powerful things that God has done. You're going to be hearing about some of those things as well. I want you to know that what you're a part of is something bigger than you. What I'm a part of is something bigger than me. But just like Nehemiah, you have to be Nehemiah for this generation. You have to be the one that seeks the face of God, that stands in the gap, that's willing to build something that can rescue those that are under attack. We cannot have personal non-involvement. There is no time, and the situation is too urgent. It's time to build. It's our year to build. Do you hear what I'm saying to you? When you see the thing God has called you to do, it starts to get inside you so it can get outside of you. This is called vision. It's a plan that God has given us. New strategies to reach people. New things that God has called us to do. New ways and accesses. God has given us new connections with people in government, even high in places of government. How many know we are the Nehemiah for this generation? We have new opportunities for a Christian school that have been provided, at least for this situation. We're talking about this earlier. We're going to have to build some buildings to expand for the school. And I believe that God is going to bring so many souls into the house of God that it's not going to be too much longer before we're going to need another sanctuary. Because God is doing something in the city, and he's doing something with us. It's vision. But it has to get inside you before it can get outside of you. Not only that, there are things in many of your lives that God has called you to do personally. He's equipping you with vision, and he's going to provide you the credibility and the resources to do what he's called you to do. But when he does, don't forget the purpose for it. Don't forget your purpose. Now comes the most important building strategy of all, and then we're going to wrap the message up today. Verse 17. Then I said to them, now he goes to the people. He surveyed. He has the vision, and he says, you see the distress that we are in. And I want you to pay attention to one key word. He says, we. You see the distress that we are in. How Jerusalem lies in waste, and its gates are burned with fire. Come and let us build the wall of Jerusalem, that we may no longer be a reproach. And I told them of the hand of my God, which had been good upon me, and also of the king's words that were spoken to me. And here's how they responded. Let us rise up and build. Then they set their hands to work. I'm calling for you to do something this year that you've never been. If you're a part of this church, if you're new to the church, I'm calling you to rise up and set your hands to build like you've never built before. Set your hands to serve in ways you've never served before. Set your face to reach people. Talk to people at work. Talk to people that you've never talked to before that need to be connected to the house of God. It is your time and season to put your hands to work. I'm calling you to give like you've never given before. And as you do, God is going to bring divine resources from supernatural connections, just like he did for Nehemiah. You are the Nehemiah for this generation. An important principle in building is you have to surround yourself with the right people. Get away from the naysayers and everybody that's negative and says you can't do it and that'll never happen, and get around people with some faith. Amen? That's what Nehemiah did, and they said, yes, we're in this together. We're going to put our hands to work too. Amos 3:3, Amos said, how can two walk together unless they are agreed? You can't get where you're going unless there's agreement. Study after study shows that people cannot succeed at building anything without deep connections to other people. He says, we. He's identifying himself with the problem, and he's committing himself to be a part of the solution. Say we. Dwight Moody says, I would rather find 100 men to do the work than for me to do the work for 100 men. I love how the people didn't respond. They didn't make excuses. They didn't say, well, we tried this before and it didn't work. They didn't say, don't rock the boat. We don't need more drama here in Jerusalem. No, they said, we're ready to build. And then God gives him the opportunity again. But when they start to step in, they're all excited, they're passionate, they're ready to go. How many know when you get passionate about the word of God and he opens opportunity for you, it doesn't mean the devil just packs up and leaves you alone. When you choose to do the will of God, you're picking a fight with the devil. Just know it, but don't you quit. Don't you stop. Don't back down just because the devil brings an attack against you. You need to set your face like a flint that no matter what, I will build what God called me to build. We will see it accomplished. If it doesn't happen this way, we'll find this way. If this way doesn't work, we'll create another way. But we will see what God has called us to do completed. So Sanballat and Tobiah and another man named Geshem heard of it, and they laughed and they despised them. And they said, what do you think you're doing? Will you rebel against the king? They didn't know who Nehemiah was coming in the name of. The devil doesn't realize who you're coming in the name of. So I answered and I said to them, the God of heaven himself will prosper us. Therefore, we, his servants, will arise and build. But you have no heritage or right or memorial in Jerusalem. This is not your place. This is not your city. God did not give this to you. Devil, this is not your place. This is not your city. Devil, this is not your household. It's my household. It's the household of God. Come on, devil, this is not your workplace, it's my workplace. And when I step my feet on it, it belongs to God. Just like when Nehemiah stepped into Jerusalem. Come on, somebody, you have to hear me today. When you set your face to do what God is calling you to do, you invite an attack of the enemy, but you be ready to pay the price when you step in the arena. Because if you're gonna succeed at building, you have to be a person who will stand resisting the toe to go down and pull you under. Resisting the opposition and say, I'm gonna do it anyway. Nehemiah was scared when he approached the king, but sometimes even if you're afraid, you still have to do it anyway. Do it scared, right? What was Nehemiah's response? The God of heaven will prosper us. Can I give you a prophetic word today? The God of heaven will prosper you. Devil has no right or memorial in this city. He has no right or memorial in your neighborhood. He has no right or memorial in your workplace. He has no right or memorial in your school. It belongs to God. And we have to tell the enemy that he has no right to remain on the territory of God. We have to have a Nehemiah for our generation. We have to have a Nehemiah. You have to grab a hold of the opportunity that God is making for you today. Would you stand to your feet with me? I'm sorry, I know we've gone late today and we have a lot in the service, but I believe God wants to do something right now. If you'll hang with me for just a moment, because God wants to speak into your life. He's stirring something up for you. You need to hear me as if these words were God speaking directly to your heart. I want you to hear these words because God is shaking you. There's people in this room that God has made promises to you. You've held on to things and you've expected things that you haven't seen yet. Some of you may have put it up on the shelf, but as I've been preaching to you today, God's brought it to your remembrance. Today, I want to pray for the open door of opportunity for you. If that's you, you've been expecting something that you haven't seen before, I want to pray for you. If you've had promises of God in your life, things that you want to get to and you haven't got to them yet, you might have even been frustrated. You might even feel like something's been sabotaged in your life. Let me tell you, God will open, if this door closed, God will open a door over here for you. I don't know who I'm preaching to today, but if that's you right now, I want you to get out of your seat and I want you to come down first. We're going to pray corporately, but I want to bring this to a personal level too. If that's you, I want you to come down. We're going to pray that God is going to open the door for you. Some of you here today, you feel like the children of Israel in Jerusalem. You've been so discouraged because it feels like every time you stand up, the rug's been pulled out from under you. Today, God says, dust yourself off and stand up again. Don't let the toe pull you under. Today, God is breaking discouragement and depression off of lives. It is time. We don't have time to be discouraged or depressed. We have too much to do. There's too much urgency. We have to be who God has called us to be. This is our time and our season today. I'm speaking vision to you as your pastor, but I'm speaking to you personally too. Don't let go of the promises of God. Don't let go. His promises are true. His word is true. It doesn't return to itself void. And let me tell you, the same thing's going to happen to us as a church. Get ready to see what God is going to do. Come on, if you're up front, I want you to lift both of your hands up. If you're at your seats, just stretch your hands forward right now. If you're up at the front of this building right now, I want you to begin to prophesy to your own promise. I want you to begin to prophesy to your promise. I want you to speak the promises of God. Speak the word of God over your life, your family, the things, your expectations. Speak to it right now. Speak to it. God is making you the prophet for your own situation in this moment right now. You speak to your situation in your life right now. Come on, church. Begin to pray with me right now in the name of Jesus. The promises of God are true. The promises of God are true right now. Don't let go of the promise of God. I break discouragement in the name of Jesus. His word is true. His power is true over you. Come on, Lord. I invite you to step through the open door of opportunity. To take advantage, to step into the place that God has called you to do. Come on, are you ready? Are you ready to step into the place that God is calling you to? His hand is in front of you. You can't see it, but God's gonna pull back the curtain. Come on, it's the year of His promise. Come on, April, it's the year of His promise over you. It's the year of His promise today. On New Year's Eve, Kevin prophesied, it's the year of the open door. Come on. God's opening doors of opportunity so we can build what He's called us to build. Come on, in the name of Jesus, it's a new day. It's a new chapter. Don't look behind. Quit looking behind. Look forward, says the Lord. Look forward. It's a new day. It's a new day. Jesus. Come on.
I believe you're my Lord.
Come on. Waymaker,
Waymaker,
chainbreaker.
Chainbreaker.
Hey, I speak into your destiny today. I speak into it today. I speak into the callings and the gifts on your life. I speak into it today. Jesus, I call you right now to be who He's called you to be. Come on, prophesy to your promise. Prophesy to your promise today. Prophesy to your promise today. Get a hold of God right now. Oh, Rasa. Hey, Kanabosha. Come on right now. Lord, I just thank you, God, that you are doing your work. God, that you have spoken something. Come on, God has been divinely guiding your footsteps. It's a new chapter. It's a new place to open something that God spoke to you 20 years ago about. And the hand of the Lord is going to fulfill His word. He's fulfilling His promises. He's pulling on the passion of your heart and the calling that He put on you. Come on, in Jesus' name, right now. Come on, prophesy. Prophesy to the promise today. Come on, it's in you. It's something in you. God's revealing you on the inside. so he can show you your next step, the things that you're doing, the dream. Come on, I'm speaking to the dream today here in Jesus' name. I'm speaking to the dream right now. Come on. Prophesy to your promise. Prophesy to your promise. Speak it. Come on, you're praying to the God of heaven. You're praying to the Lord of heaven today. The purposes of God. In the name of Jesus. Come on, prophesy to your promise today. Pull on those things inside that you've seen in the dreams and visions of your heart. Come on, look for the opportunity. Opportunity in Jesus' name. More than enough. Come on, what do you need? He's more than enough. I will watch you do what you said you would do. I will. Come on. Just lift your hands up high. Lord, as a church, we lift our hands up to you. And Lord, we speak together with one voice, God, that we will do what you've called us to do. We will build what you've called us to build. We will open the doors that you call us to open, God. We'll seize the opportunities, God. And we'll see something we've never seen before this year in the name of Jesus. And everybody that believes it, shout amen.
Amen.
Amen. Hallelujah. Here's what I want you to do. Before next Sunday, I want you to find somebody that you can bring to the house of God with you. God's going to open up opportunities for you to bring somebody with you next week. Between now and next week, don't forget. Come on, if they say no, keep inviting. Somebody's going to come with you next week. Come on, there's no time. There's an urgency. We have to get our hands to work and begin to reach out into the places of our influence. And God is going to use you to love somebody, serve somebody, minister to somebody, and bring somebody. He's going to do it, amen? And he's going to open supernatural doors of provision and promotion for you. I believe that with all my heart. God bless you. Amen. Love two or three people today before you go. There's no rush. We're going to continue ministry. Have a blessed week in the name of Jesus.